हेलो, टुडे वी शैल सी वाइंडिंग ऑन रोटर स्पिनिंग विद द बैकग्राउंड दैट वी हैव ऑफ ड्रम वाइंडिंग, प्रिसिजन वाइंडिंग एज वेल एज स्टेप प्रिसिजन वाइंडिंग. लेट अस हैव अ लुक एट व्हाट काइंड ऑफ वाइंडिंग सिस्टम इज देयर फॉर रोटर स्पिनिंग. सो व्हाट आर द एडवांटेजेस ऑफ रोटर पैकेजेस ओवर वाइंडर पैकेजेस? लेट अस हैव अ लुक एट दैट फर्स्ट. Number of piecings are only 2 to 3% of that of the winder package. Since the rotor spun package is wound up continuously, while the winder package is made up of yarns from smaller ring bobbins of 60 to 120 grams weight that are then joined by splicing. So, in case of a rotor package, it's a continuous yarn that is coming out of the machine. And therefore, you do not require a lot of piecings, and the number of piecings, as you can see, is only 2 to 3%. Whereas in case of the winder, where the material comes from a ring frame in the form of small ring bobbins, and in such cases, there would be a lot of splicing that would be involved, and therefore, the number of piecings would be high. So winding on rotor is carried out at 350 meters per minute as compared to 1400 meters per minute in a normal winder. So therefore, the speed being lesser here, it results in a better package build. Also, the yarn length on each package can be kept uniform so that they all exhaust at the same time at the downstream processes like say warping. So what are the requirements of a rotor wound package? We know that the package density must be uniform as far as possible from one package to the other. The yarn lengths should be same on all the packages. There should be an adaptable way of winding densities. That means if I want to change winding densities, there should be some system by which I can do it. And this can be done by adjusting or varying the yarn tension and the angle of wind. The packages that we might produce on rotor spinning must be free of patterning. There should be a facility for yarn waxing wherever necessary. And also there should be some amount of yarn reserve on the package so that the next package starting end can be knotted before the package runs out. And in this manner, we could have a continuous running at the downstream process without any stoppage for package change. So the package must fulfill all these important requirements. So having seen those, let us have a look at the package density and the yarn length, how they are controlled on the rotor wound packages. So before that, let us just have a look at the passage once again. We have this quality control on rotor spinning. Then there is a pair of take-up rollers through which the yarn goes. Then it will go over the waxing block. And then there is a winding drum, as you can see, and you get a cross wound package. So the tension in the yarn above the take up rollers is considerably low and is also adjustable. Whatever tension is there in this region between the take up roller and the package is going to be low, and it is also adjustable. A low winding tension produces a softer package, and winding at higher tension produces a compact package with higher yarn content. But when you are producing the yarn at higher tensions for getting a higher yarn content, there is always a risk of reduced yarn elongation that you might find because of the higher tensions that are involved. So coming to the next point, cylindrical as well as 2-degree conical packages are wound by one part winding drum, and the conical package of higher taper angles are wound using a three part differential winding drums, which we shall see later in the lecture. This kind of a drum is needed to allow the different surface speeds at the two ends of a high taper conical package. So the conical packages which are higher of higher taper of say 3 degrees 50 minutes or 4 degrees 20 minutes, such packages cannot be wound with a uniform density on say normal one part winding drum, for which therefore I will have to use a three part differential winding drum. The uniformity in the yarn length on all the packages can be achieved with individual length measuring devices. We can have such kind of an installation on the rotor spinning, as and the length variability should be within plus minus 0.5%. Now, in the older method, what used to happen was the package was doffed whenever the package reached a certain diameter. And because of this practice, what would happen is the yarn length on the packages, various packages, would be different. And that this would majorly happen because of the tension variations which would be there from package to package, and which would lead to a ultimate or a final variation in the yarn lengths on the package. And such kind of packages would then lead to higher yarn losses in the downstream process, because some amount of yarn would always remain on the package when the entire creel would get exhausted. And also there is increased creeling requirement in such cases if the yarn lengths varies from package to package. So we should see that there is a uniformity in yarn length over the entire package range that we produce on rotor spinning. So compensation of winding tension, we just said that we can control the winding tensions during winding. So there are two elements that are involved. One is a compensation bow and the yarn tension bar, which will help us in maintaining a uniform tension. So now what is the cause of this kind of variation in yarn tension during winding? Let us see that first. So the path length, if we observe closely, there is a variation between the path length between takeoff rollers and the right and left edge of the package. When the yarn is being wound on the edges of the package, it results in a higher tension, because it will be traveling over a larger length between the takeoff roller and the package, whereas when it is winding in the middle of the package, the distance between the takeoff rollers and the package would be smaller. So we would find tension variation from the edge of the package to the middle when winding is taking place. So to avoid or to prevent this from happening over a wide range of variation, it can be made uniform by using a compensation bow, that is a small device which is installed over here, and a yarn tension bar, which is shown over here in blue. But it is only effective for winding cylindrical and 2-degree taper conical packages. This will not be effective for higher taper conical packages. And to maintain a uniform tension during winding, we might have to go for a 3-part differential winding cylinder to compensate for the differences in speed that would occur from a small package to a large package. And these would be compensated very easily by using a 3-part differential winding cylinder. So before we see the 3-part differential winding cylinder, let us just revise our passage. We can see the compensation bar clearly here in the video. So having seen this, let us go and have a look at 3-part differential winding cylinder. This is how it looks. It's a 3-part winding cylinder with powered middle section A, which is shown over here. There are two powered side sections shown as B, which is a wheel and a disc differential gear C. And the friction coatings, that is D, for driving the package. So this is the kind of drum that would be required for higher conical tapers in case of cone winding. So let us look at a video where we can see this particular drum while running.
And doffing, removal of full packages.
So we just saw that winding drum. There is one more video which clearly shows the drum in a front view.
To the rolling open end of yarn found there, thus the name open end spinning. The yarn is withdrawn and the process becomes continuous.
So having seen this kind of winding cylinder, let us look at the winding angle of wind on the rotor wound packages. We already know that the yarn winding angle mainly affects the package density and can be precisely adjusted by adjusting the traverse speed. So the angle of wind can be varied between 30 degrees to 40 degrees in case of rotor spinning. Larger the angle, we know that lower is the density and therefore softer is the package. The density of the package also depends on the winding tension, contact pressure of package, winding roll and the yarn count. We have seen this earlier in detail. We have also seen that finer yarn gives a higher package density. So with this, let us come to patterning or the anti-patterning device. Patterning, we know that it reduces the dye take-up capacity in those regions and creates problem during unwinding, and therefore patterning has to be avoided. Patterning will occur when the ratio of the package RPM and the traverse speed or the is an integer. Traverse ratio, when it is an integer, it will always give you patterning at those areas. So traverse ratio is nothing but package RPM upon traverse speed, which is the ratio which we have written over here. So traverse ratio, when I rearrange this traverse ratio into traverse speed, I will get as package RPM. But we also know that package RPM into package diameter is equal to drum diameter to drum speed. So arranging this and they are equal. So when I rearrange this, I get this particular formula. Package RPM is equal to drum diameter to drum speed upon package diameter. And the numerator is a constant. So package RPM is constant divided by package diameter. So substituting package RPM, this particular equation in the previous formula, what I get is traverse ratio into traverse speed into the package diameter, which I can bring it in the numerator, is equal to drum diameter into drum speed, which is equal to constant. So this is an entire equation that I get. In the above formula, we see that patterning can occur when the traverse ratio is an integer. So we can find out the package diameters at which the patterning shall occur. Therefore, the anti-patterning device varies the traverse speed, resulting in the change in the angle of wind, and therefore prevents the buildup of pattern. So by changing the traverse speed, there is a way out to avoid patterning. Therefore, at a given traverse speed, the patterning will occur at certain package diameters when the traverse ratio is an integer. So with this, if we look at one numerical on patterning, this entire concept will become more clearer. So let us see this numerical. If the traverse speed is 320 double traverses per minute and the package diameter is 150 mm at a speed of 960 rpm, calculate the package diameters at which patterning occurs when the maximum package diameter is 200 mm and the minimum package diameter is 70 mm. So using the above formula that we have just seen, I just substitute the value for traverse speed and the drum diameter and the drum speed. This is not actually the drum diameter, but this would be constant at any particular given instance, and it would be equal to the product of the package diameter and the package RPM at that particular moment. So since these values are given, this would be a constant. So 150 into 960 is equal to this particular left hand side, where we need to find out the package diameters which will give us patterning. And it will give me patterning only when the traverse ratio is an integer. So substituting integer values for traverse ratio, I can get the package diameters at which patterning might occur. So therefore, when the traverse ratio takes on values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the values of the package diameters are 450, 225, 150, 112.5, 90, 75, and 64.2 mm respectively. The first two values and the last value of the package diameter are beyond the maximum and the minimum package diameters. As we can see, this is above 200, which is given for us over here. And the minimum package diameter is 70. Again, this is out of range. So dropping these three values, the first two and the last one, we find that patterning will occur at 150, 112.5, 90, and 75 mm diameters during package buildup for a traverse ratio of 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we can easily find out the diameters at which patterning might take place and take appropriate action by change in the traverse speed. The anti-patterning device on rotor spinning therefore shall vary the traverse speed, resulting in the change in the angle of wind. Of course, some change of angle of wind will happen, but it will prevent the buildup of any kind of patterns. So now, having seen patterning, let us see edge displacement at the package ends. The edges of the package, that is the reversal point of traverse, at such points there is a short pause before the traversing guide returns, and therefore because of this the yarn is wound at the edges at the same place, and this causes a kind of accumulation, yarn accumulation at the edges, and it would lead to excessive hard and compact package edges. There is a slippage at the package edges due to such kind of coils being laid one on top of the other, and this might create disturbances or problems in the downstream processes due to slough off or slippage. Then if the edges are too hard, then it also will give me differences in the dye take up between the center and the edge of the package. So these are the kind of problems that we might face if the package ends are too hard. So the remedy for hard package edges would be to avoid a shift in the to avoid hard packages, I would want to give a shift in the reversal point, and this is added to the traverse motion. The shift may be from 0 to 5 mm in case of conventional gears, which is shown over here. The shift is there, as you can see, the traverse has moved more towards the right, and that is why there's a shift and the coils are not laid exactly on top of the other at the edges of the package. At the same time, in case of some windings, we see that the shift is given to the extent of 0 to 30 mm, which results in an advantage in the production of packages for dyeing, and this would give me low density edges, and such kind of high shifts are seen, can be represented by this particular diagram here, where we see again that the reversal points have shifted from layer to layer, and that is why we can avoid hard package edges. So we come to the point, the topic of yarn waxing. Yarn waxing is a requirement for yarn used in knitting where they are bent sharply around the needles, and therefore we would require some kind of yarn waxing to smoothen the yarns, because rough yarns will cause disturbances as well as broken threads and wear in case of during knitting. So we need to smoothen it by yarn waxing. To improve the running performance, they have to be waxed. By the application of 0.5 to 3 grams per kg of yarn, there is a drastic reduction up to 40 to 50% of the coefficient of friction that is seen. Wax differs in their hardness, melting point, and as well as penetration. So we must choose the right kind of wax for our application. In the rotor spinning machine, waxing can be done at the spinning position. The waxing block is arranged between the takeoff roller and the package, enabling small particles of wax to get deposited onto the yarn. The wax block is pushed automatically by a spring into an optimum position, and the rotation is stopped in case the ends or there's a breakage or there's an ends down situation. So the waxing device always requires compensation bow or yarn tension bars. Different kinds of covers at or below the waxing device is applied, and this will prevent the loose wax particles from falling on the sliver in the can that is below, that is the feed can, and prevent it from getting contaminated. So having seen this waxing, let us refresh our memory with the passage or of the waxing block. Let us see where it is placed exactly. This is a take-up ruler, this is the quality control. This is the waxing block. The yarn is rubbed on the waxing block before being wound. So So let us see the advantages that this kind of rotor spun packages give us in the downstream process. First advantage is that the rewinding stage after spinning can be eliminated entirely. Modern yarn quality monitoring systems on rotor spinning machines detect and eliminate yarn defects at the spinning position itself. Yarns for knitting can be directly waxed, as we've just seen, at the spinning positions of the rotor spinning, and be supplied in different forms of winding parameters, that is cylindrical, 2 degrees taper, 3 degrees 51 and so on, 4 degrees 21 minutes and so on. So also dyeing packages with reduced package densities are also possible, also at the outer edges. So allow the packages to produced that is produced on the rotor spinning to be directly used in high pressure dyeing equipment. So package density of a soft wound packages cotton package for package dyeing would be 0.33 to 0.38 grams per cc, and the package density for a hard package would be 0.38 to 0.42 grams per cc. So elimination of the winding stage after ring spinning also has a qualitative advantage, not only in terms of, you know, eliminating a process, there is a quality advantage also, because during the winding stage, if at all we are going after a ring frame, if we go for a winding stage, there would definitely be guides and tensioners that are there, and they would result in a nappy yarn due to rubbing. So this particular, if we are able to eliminate the winding stage, the quality of the yarn is also seen to getting to be improved. There are almost 75% lower end breakages in weaving preparatory due to better regularity of the rotor spun yarns, lower hairiness as well as knot free yarns. So overall we see a good quality of piecing. The robo piecing that is there on the rotor spinning displays almost 90% of the original yarn strength and are also identical in appearance. So the robo piecing does a very good job in terms of restoring the original yarn strength, and also the appearance wise it would be as good as the yarn that was freshly spun. So with the this kind of piecing we get a continuous yarn for either in the downstream processes. So having seen this, we see that there are a lot of advantages both in weaving as well as winding as well as packages for dyeing. And we also at the same time are able to get large package sizes, up to even 6 kgs package can be produced, which is able to supply almost 4 warp beams. And so this would definitely seem to be a very good advantage. So having seen, let us look at the specific advantages for knitting. Rotor spun yarns produce less fly. We have seen this earlier, the property of a rotor spun yarn, because of the wrapper fibers that are there on the yarn surface, we find that it has lesser hairiness as well as the capacity to produce less fly during processing, and therefore there is a reduction in the knitted fabric defect, which is known as holes. Normally these holes would be produced because there is a failure in the loop formation by the needle because of a lot of accumulation of fly, and this can be avoided entirely, and we could see an improvement in the knitted fabric quality by elimination of the defect of holes here. And also we see that there is a 40% less ends down in circular knitting as well as 50% lesser ends down in case of weaving. There is also a 40% reduction in creeling and joining the packages, since we see that we can easily produce large packages up to even 5 to 6 kgs, and this would result in lesser knots in the knitted fabric also. And overall we see that there is a lot of advantage in terms of a good quality of producing a good quality knitted fabric. So with this we come to the end of this today's lecture. Thank you.